According to his word, you shall receive it. There's nothing too hard for my God to work things out. He's gonna work things out. Keep the faith, my brother. Keep the faith, my sister.
Praise the Lord and good morning, saints. I am here to render the Living Church's weekly happenings. Join us every Sunday morning for virtual Sunday school beginning at 10 o'clock a.m. for toddlers, 12:30 for beginners, 1 o'clock for preteens, 1:30 for teens, and 2 p.m. with adults. Join us every Monday through Friday morning beginning at 5 o'clock a.m. for morning intercessory prayer via conference call. Noonday prayer is held every Tuesday and Friday via conference call. Join us Wednesdays at noon for noonday Bible study via conference call and Wednesday evenings beginning at 6 o'clock p.m. with corporate prayer via Zoom, followed by 7 p.m. Zoom Bible study. It is that time of year again. Time for our Thanksgiving food drive. This year, we are accepting pre-packaged Thanksgiving boxes. We are asking that all families donate as many boxes as they can with all of the necessary items for a Thanksgiving meal. Drop-off will be Tuesday, November 23rd, between the hours of 4:30 and 6:30 p.m. If you know any families in need this year, please reach out to any Sunday school teacher. Also, if you'd like to sign up to donate a Thanksgiving meal box, reach out to any Sunday school teacher via text or email. And as we are still in the season of giving, we will be continuing this year with our Meal and a Blanket project as well. This is in support of our Charlotte homeless community. Care package items could include blankets, water bottles, socks, gift cards for a restaurant, hand wipes, toothbrush or toothpaste, comb, small brush, and a note of encouragement for uplifting Bible verse. If you would like to donate a care package, please reach out to any Sunday school teacher. Care packages will be collected on December 14th at the church between the hours of 4:30 and 6 o'clock p.m. Please be reminded that all Zoom meeting links, meeting IDs, and passwords are located on our church website at www.tlcooljc.org. That concludes this morning's announcements. We ask that you please govern yourselves accordingly.
Weapon formed against me shall prosper. It won't work. No weapon formed against me shall Oh yes, going and growing with God's flow. That's God's design, and therefore it is our expectation. We are growing while we are going and flowing with God's will for our lives. This is part of being the Lord's prisoners while serving out our sentence here on earth. Without specifying any particular thing or situation, Scripture says, 1 Thessalonians 5:18, in everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. When we are prisoners of the Lord, we are in Jesus, and in Jesus, everything is the will of God. Now, when you're outside of the will of God, that's something different. But when you are in Jesus, everything is the will of God. Just like Jesus did all to save this world, we are called upon to be able to adjust to all situations so that we can at least save some. So it doesn't matter what you're going through, what you have to do, it's all the will of God when you are in Jesus. In Jesus, the flexibility to save some requires that we grow with God's flow in order to grow to the point of always making winning souls our priority. Physical growth is as simple as eating food and swallowing it. Your body does all the rest. In Jesus, growing in God is as simple as hearing the word of God and doing it. The blood of Jesus does and has done all the rest. This is why all we have to do is be like a sheep being taken to the slaughter, and we are more than overcomers. Yet, you mean I do not have to fight back or try to defend my opinion, or when people go off on me that really need to be saved, I don't have to get hurt by it or feel like I got to defend what I've just said or who I am? Or try to get even with them? No, you do not. In fact, you can be killed all day long, and at the end of the day, you will still be more than a conqueror in Jesus through the one that loved us. Sounds good to me. I think I'd rather stay the Lord's prisoner and serve out my time willingly. In the grace and mercy of God, I know justice is served, and I am getting what I did not deserve, a new life in Jesus. Or King David knew he did not get the death that he deserved, but he threw himself on the mercy of God's divine court. Look what he says in his repentance and confession. Recorded in Psalm 51:1. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness, according unto the multitudes of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. In his plea for mercy, he went on to fully acknowledge the magnitude of his sin. Verse 4, against you and you only have I sinned and done this evil in your sight, that you may be found just when you speak and blameless when you judge. When we sin against God, we must never minimize the magnitude of our sin so that we do not become discouraged when judgment occurs, especially since we never get the death that we deserve. When we were yet without strength, Jesus died for us. He did not deserve that death. We deserved that death. So the least that we can do is respond by confessing our sin and not minimizing the magnitude of it. Confession is the call of what God calls it. Because of it, because of what Jesus stepped up to do for us, his mercy is so tender now that 1 John 1:8-10 said, listen, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sin, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Saints, that's not just mercy, that's tender mercy. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Also, Apostle Paul knew that he was getting what he did not deserve when the Lord made him a prisoner to suffer for the cause of Christ. He knew he deserved death, but instead Jesus gave him life without the possibility of parole. Paul knew that he did not even deserve that level of leniency. Let's know what he says to Timothy in 1 Timothy 1:15-17. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. However, for this reason, I obtained mercy that in me first, Jesus Christ might show all longsuffering as a pattern to those who are going to believe in on him for everlasting life. Now, to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, to God who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Somebody listening to me was like Saul, the chief sinner, transformed Paul, the militant saint, and the rest of us who now serve the Lord with gladness. We were so wrong in our sin that Jesus had to apprehend us. Jesus arrested us and charged us with kicking against the pricks of his drawing power and gave us the maximum sentence, life in ministry without the possibility of parole. There are no special privileges or entitlements in prison. Note the apostle's words to the church at Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 9:16-18. For if I preach the gospel, I have nothing to boast about, for I am under compulsion, for woe is me if I do not preach the gospel. For if I do this voluntarily, I have a reward. But if against my will, I have a stewardship entrusted to me. What then is my reward? That when I preach the gospel, I may offer the gospel without charge, so as not to make full use of my right in the gospel. See, they didn't see him as a real preacher because he wasn't charging for the word. They had all kinds of negative things to say about him. The apostle Paul didn't go off on them. Oh, instead, he explained to them, oh, that he is a prisoner of the Lord and he's compelled to preach the gospel. As the Lord's prisoner, he is compelled by love and he is compelled to preach. There is nothing to boast when you are in bonds for Jesus. In fact, even when you are in prison, period, we do not preach for pay because no one gets paid for being a prisoner. I'm a prisoner of the Lord. So I'm doing my time voluntarily. This is what the Apostle Paul is saying. I'm volunteering my time, going and growing with God's flow, because you don't expect to get paid when you are doing your time in prison. I'm a prisoner of the Lord. So if I never get an honorarium, I must preach the word or the logos, as Paul told Timothy, preach the word, the logos, which is Jesus, preach Jesus, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. No, there's no pay in prison, but I've already served 35 years of my life sentence preaching the word of God. And like King David, who did his time willingly, I too can say, as he said in Psalms 37:25, I have been young and now I am old, getting old, slight modification. Yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. No, you don't get paid for being a prisoner. Philippians 4:19, he says, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. There have been those who spent a long time in prison who were released and did something against the law so they could go back to prison, because life outside was just too difficult. It was hard to find a job. People looked at them differently, treated them differently. They had a scar on the record for the rest of their life. At least in prison, they could depend on a place to sleep and three meals each day. The needs are taken care of by the state when they're in prison. When you are the Lord's prisoner, he supplies your need. I do not know about other prisoners or what they did to get arrested and are now doing time in Jesus. But I do know that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. No exceptions. So I can only speak for me. When Jesus arrested me, he threw the book at me. And 40 years later, I still am an adamant student of his book, the Word of God. I found it to be a lamp unto my feet. It's flickering when I'm reading it. Sometimes I don't understand it, but I can see. But as I keep walking with him, it begins to shine bright. It's a light unto my path. Oh, when you read God's word, even when you don't understand it, just keep walking with the word of God, and eventually it's going to shine bright. Because goodness and mercies follow you. Sometimes you have to look back and see just how good the word of God really was, and just how thankful you are because you obeyed the word of God. Because this is the will of God in Christ concerning you. When you're in Christ, it's God's will. Because, oh, you know, we want to say, well, it's not God's permissive will, submissive will. Listen, when you are in Jesus, and you're really in Jesus and not trying to be in yourself, whatever is happening to you, it's God's will. Listen, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. Psalm 119 and 89. Forever, O Lord, your word is settled in heaven. Oh, yeah. Jesus threw the book at me, and I'm still a willing student of his word. No, you do not get paid for being in prison, but there is a price that you pay for being the Lord's prisoner. Matthew 16 and 24, then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Acts 14 and 22, Apostle Paul tell church leaders, we must through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of God. 2 Timothy 2 and 12, if we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. Oh, God, going and growing with God's flow so that we can be all things to all people and at least win some. When the Lord locked me up in his will, there were times when I thought he threw away the key. Oh, God, 2 Corinthians 4, 8 through 11 described the way I feel. We are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always caring about in the body the dying of our Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. You know how sometimes you feel like if it's not one thing, it's another. Oh, boy, but when you're in Jesus, oh, it's all going somewhere, growing in God. For we who live are always delivered to death for Jesus' sake, that the life of Jesus also may be revealed, manifested in our mortal bodies. Oh, yes. When you're a prisoner of the Lord, you're not in control of what happens to you. Even, but when you can be cast down, you're still not forsaken, because God's purpose is being manifested in your life. All things to all people, that we may save somebody. It's all right, because we're going with God's flow and growing more like Jesus and having the desire just to see people saved. Oh, no matter how we are treated in the Lord's prison, we must have the heart of God to see people saved. And that requires going with God's flow so we can grow to the point to where our flesh is no longer trying to live and defend itself. No, Jesus did not throw away the key when he locked you up in his will. Apostle John was a prisoner and exiled on the Isle of Patmos and left to die. But because he too was the Lord's prisoner, he was in the spirit on the Lord's day, and he seen Jesus like he had never seen him before. Revelation 1, 17 through 19. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. But he laid his right hand on me, saying to me, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have, here it is, the keys of Hades and of death. Write the things which you have seen and all the things which are and the things which will take place after this. Yes, it gets difficult being a prisoner of the Lord. It's cross bearing. It's dying every day. It's being like a sheep slaughtered, oh God, on the altar. It's like being killed all day long. So you listening to me, I know sometimes you feel like Jesus locked you up and threw away the key. No, he still has the keys. And that's why we go with God's flow as we grow through and go through our assignment, because we are growing more and more like Jesus each day, who put his life on the line to see the world have an opportunity to be once again at peace with their creator, our God. One day, we who love him will see him. And like John did in his experience on the Isle of Patmos, we too will one day see Jesus like we have never seen him before. For look at what 1 John 3:1-3 says. Behold, what manner of love the Father have bestowed upon us, that we should be called the children of God. We don't deserve that, saints. And such we are. We really are God's children. For this cause, the world knows us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now we are the children of God, and it is not yet made manifest what we shall be. We know that if he shall be manifested, we shall be like him, for we shall see him even as he is. And everyone that have this hope set on him purifieth himself, even as he or the Lord is pure. As we hope in God, even against hope, we are being purified in the process. Hold, we're living out the love of Jesus. And the living out the love of Jesus is a demonstration of the hope that we have in being fully like him one day, going and growing in God. Living out our love for him by filling up the afflictions he left behind, bearing our cross. That's part of our growing pains, but it's a purifying process. Listen, saints, hear me today. Your growing pains is also a purifying process. Saints, let us live out the love of Jesus. Go and grow with the Lord's flow. Be willing to be flexible enough, because somebody needs to be saved, just like he saved us. There will be times when you have no clue what the Lord is doing and why it is being done in your life, and why things are occurring to you the way that they are occurring. These times can be disheartening and have you feeling despondent, and can cause you to even stop going with God's flow and risk a stunt in your spiritual growth as well. But Job said something as he grappled with this kind of moment that all prisoners of the Lord should remember as we do our time and serve out our sentence in Jesus. He was faced with uncertainty and so many unanswered questions, and he was suffering. But he said, recorded in Job 23:10-12, but he knows the way I take. When he has tried me, I shall come forth as gold. My foot has held fast to his path. I have kept his way and not turned aside. I have not departed from the command of his lips. I have treasured the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. Because he stayed with God's flow whenever all hell had broken loose on him. Going with God's flow, he saw God give him, oh, so much more than he had lost. Going with God's flow means that you do not have to always know the way that you are going. He knows the way he is taking you, prisoner of the Lord. And we have to trust him that where he is taking us is better than where we were before. Oh, Psalm 23 says it like this. Oh, he leads us in the path of righteousness. And that path of righteousness is through the valley and the shadow of death. Oh, but on the other side of the valley, he has already prepared a table before me in the presence of my enemy, with a cup that is already running over. Oh, somebody missed that. You didn't have to fill it up. The cup was already there running over, waiting for you to just go through and grow through so that you could see where God was taking you. And it's always better than where you were before. He anoints my head with oil. Listen, saints, no matter how difficult life gets, and the Lord protects our mind when we trust in him. Oh, he anoints our head with oil. He anoints my head with oil. Do not sit there and stress out because of the world around you. The Lord is trying to anoint your head with the oil of his word, which is peace and patience. His word says in Isaiah 26:1-4, when you trust in him in that day, this song will be sung in the land of Judah. We have a strong city. God would appoint salvation for walls and bulwarks. We're living in that day. Open the gates that the righteous nation, which keeps the truth, may enter in. You will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you, because he trusts in you. Trust in the Lord, for in Yah, the Lord is everlasting strength. When you trust in the Lord, he protects your mind. Oh God, you don't stress out. You don't go into a bout of depression. He protects your mind. Oh, he anoints my head with oil. Oh God, sheep had their heads anointed with oil. Oh God, to keep the aggravation of bugs and everything else from happening on their head. And so if you got bugs that are trying to get into your brain and confuse you, make you think that something is going wrong and everybody is against you, oh, God anoints your head with his oil. God wants you to be at peace, and he'll give you real peace when you trust in him. So like Job eventually discovered, those who maintain their integrity when life says do something different will eventually emerge from their trial looking more like our Lord, looking better than they did before, more like our Lord. Oh, saints, let's go with God's flow so we can grow with God's flow. Going and growing with God's flow. When you do not know what to do or where to turn or how God is taking you or where God is taking you, that's when you stand still until you see the salvation of the Lord. And like Psalm 46:8-11 says, come, behold the works of Jehovah. What desolations he have made in the earth. He maketh wars to cease unto the end of the earth. He breaketh the bow and cutteth the spear in sunder. He burneth the chariots in fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted on earth. Jehovah of hosts is with us. Saints, God is with us. And sometimes that means you be still so that you can know that he's God as you observe God work in your life. When you learn how to be still in God and stand still in God, you actually grow in God. Oh, Lord. So I'm not trying to be a super saint, but I am super determined to serve out my prison sentence willingly. Life in the Lord's prison of love is not grievous, John says in 1 John 5:3. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. Oh, God's not trying to hurt you. You don't have to grieve and be sad about what God is telling us to do. His will, his word, his commands are not grievous, because you can't lose. And whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. This is why when the Apostle Paul served out his life sentence, he concluded in 2 Timothy 4:7-8, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Oh, I'm a prisoner of the Lord, and I love his appearing. So although you do not get paid for being a prisoner, but you do get paid for being a willing and faithful prisoner of the Lord. Think about it, saints. If no one pats you on the back for what you do or openly recognize it once it is done, you keep going and growing with God's flow. Hebrews 6:10-12. For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which you have showed towards his name, in that you minister to the saints and do minister. And he says, we desire that every one of you do show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope unto the end. Oh, serve out your sinful saints and with diligence to the end, that you be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promise. Diligent to the very end, going and growing with God's flow. Oh, you thought Jesus, yeah, you thought Jesus locked you up and threw away the key. No, Jesus did not lock you up and throw away the key. His love for us is the key to going and growing in all that we encounter. We are beloved and therefore an overcomer in all things. Romans 8:37. No, in all of these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. So you have been sentenced to be all things to all people at all times. And when you go with God's flow, you grow with God's flow. And in the end, you will look more like Christ than ever before. Make disciples, saints, and do not count anyone out. Everyone is a potential disciple. The challenge is being able to make the necessary adjustments in ourselves so that we can save some and not disqualify anyone. That person that you thought could never be saved may be the very person that God is growing you and taking you through so that you can be sensitive enough to reach out to that person. Oh, God, those who approach ministry seeing everyone as someone that Jesus died for and can therefore be saved will in the process grow more and more like Jesus. But it requires growth to even see people the way God sees them. And I encourage you today to grow with God's flow. When you willingly go with God's flow, you will grow more and more like Jesus, our Lord. Oh, saints, I'm going and I'm growing with God's flow, but I'm a prisoner of the Lord. And that's what happens to prisoners. You just have to go and go with the flow. Either you grow with the flow or you fight the flow and you don't grow. Oh, God, if you're going to serve a life sentence, you might as well serve it willingly. Oh, thank God for Jesus. I'm in prison for life. I deserve life in prison because where Jesus brought me from, oh, God, I got to go and grow with God's flow. And going and growing with God's flow means that I got to be a prisoner of the Lord. I can no longer run my own life. The Apostle Paul realized that Jesus took him into the prison so that he could show other folk who's in maximum prisons of Satan how to be a model prisoner for Jesus. Oh yes, he could have really beaten up on himself because he was so wrong in what he had done. He had a zeal for God, but it wasn't according to knowledge. He was following after the law in Numbers and what was done to get rid of idolatry. And it was Phinehas used to slaughter an Israelite who brought a Moabite woman into the camp. And it was counted to him for righteousness. And the Apostle Paul was going about slaughtering Christians because the way you get the Lord to restore Israel, oh, God, is to get rid of idolatry. But he was wrong. He was killing innocent people. And there's somebody listening to me. You don't want to use your dogma to kill innocent people. Oh God, because you are wrong. If church is not helping you, it's not God. If church is hurting you, it's not God. If church is killing you, it's not God. If you are in bondage, oh God, to the rudiments and the elements of the devil, it's not God. But when you're in prison for the Lord, driven by what he is calling you to do and the mandate that he's placed upon you, oh, you are an ambassador in chains. Thank God for Jesus. He said he did not see himself as a victim of the ignorance. Instead, when he was a blaspheming and Jesus stopped him and arrested him, Apostle Paul saw himself as a type of fugitive of divine law who Jesus arrested on the way to Damascus. Jesus, when he was determined to arrest those of the way, followers of Jesus. At that point, he became a prisoner of Jesus Christ. Lord, have mercy. Oh, disciple chaser turned demon chaser. That's what the Lord will do. For him, this was not just something big that occurred and now it's over and he's free to go his own way. No, he saw himself in prison ministry for the rest of his life, and Jesus was his prison ward. From that point on, he saw himself as no longer a fugitive of the light of divine law, but a prisoner of Jesus, bearing about in his body the pains and suffering of Jesus Christ, living the prison life, a crucified life, not knowing whether somebody's going to try to mug you, oh God, not knowing when someone's going to try to take your life. The Apostle Paul was a fugitive of Judaism, but he was a prisoner of the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Sometimes you have to tell people, you got to wait in line because I got enough problems that I'm already dealing with. And you trying to dump another problem on me. But I'm already a prisoner. You can't do much more to me because I'm in jail for Jesus. And no matter what you bring down the pipe, I'm already in jail. I wish somebody would say, bring me up on charges. Lie on me. Judge me. Prejudge me. Misjudge me. Throw the book at me. Call me everything but a saint. I'm already in jail for Jesus. Lord, have mercy. If you're going to take me deeper in jail, that's fine. Add some time to my sentence, that's fine. Because whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. Beat up on me. But the Apostle Paul says, if there's no resurrection, why did I fight beasts at Ephesus? Lord, have mercy. He got into something in Ephesus where people wanted to fight him because he came against their little god, Diana. Lord, have mercy. Paul did not stop referring to it. He knew he was a prisoner of the Lord. This is not just a way to explain or make a point. He really saw the situation from a divine perspective. For the rest of his life, he was a prisoner of Jesus. And he knew that he did not get what he deserved, death. And he got what he did not deserve, grace and mercy. Even in that, he saw himself as a mercy case, so that in him, Jesus could use him as an example of mercy. Look at you looking at me right now. You know you are a mercy case. The drugs were supposed to kill you. The alcohol was supposed to took your mind out. Oh God, the death, what you did was supposed to take you out. But Jesus arrested you, brought you out, and prison is saving your life. Somebody listening to me, you know that if you weren't in the prison of the Lord, you'd be dead. If you wasn't a prisoner of the Lord, you would be the prisoner of the state. You might even be a federal prisoner, but because Jesus arrested you, locked you up in his will, wrapped you in his love, it kept the devil from throwing the book at you. Lord, have mercy. The devil tried to throw the book at you, but you said, I got the one covering me who wrote the book on divine justice. Tell the Lord, thank you. Oh, I know you're in ministry. You're a minister of the gospel. You're somebody's parent, teacher, leader, consultant, advisor, technician, expert, and free to come and go as you please. But above all that, you are in this world. You are the Lord's prisoner, and you have been sentenced to be all things to all people, that you can save some. It'll help you grow with God's flow. I wish somebody would stop focusing on themselves and start serving out their prison time in Jesus, because we too have to realize that we are the Lord's prisoners because he apprehended all of us when we were going our own way. And whatever he tells us to do, now we got to do it. Isaiah said we all were like sheep going astray. Oh God, rebelling and going our own way. But he laid the iniquities of us all upon Jesus. He became sin for us. Oh God, he went to the prison of death so he can keep us out of the prison that was destroying our lives. Oh God, I'm protected in prison. You know, some people will get out of prison and life is so bad. They can't find a job. They can't find a friend. People treat them differently. Oh God, they can't get a job because they have no money and they've been in prison. No longer can they vote. Some people will commit another crime just to go back to prison. Lord, help mercy. Whenever the devil is fighting me and life get hard, I go witness to somebody so I can stay in prison. Lord, have mercy. I go pray so I can stay in prison. Lord, have mercy. I go and talk to the Lord so I can stay in prison. I do something that aggravates the devil so I can stay in prison. I do something to chase demons so I can stay in prison. I wish somebody in here who know that you're safer in the prison of the Lord than you out in this world. Then go commit a crime against the devil. Let him know he's going to hell. Treat him like he's going to hell so you can stay in prison. Oh God, Jesus is in control and we're getting exactly what we deserve. And neither should we face our challenges like I don't deserve this or always trying to get out of prison, to be in control of our own destiny. But as a prisoner of Jesus, goodness and mercy follows you. And as I look back at the time when I lost my job and was the sole provider of a wife and four small children, losing that job over time, losing that job set me up for a greater blessing. That position me with what I needed when sickness came down hard upon my growing family, and losing my job moved me closer to my purpose of being in the counseling resources for others. And as a husband, a father, pastor, and provider, I was jobless, but because I was a prisoner of the Lord, I was jobless for Jesus. And I look back in retrospect, I see the goodness and the mercy in losing that job. And somebody, just hold on, put out your hands and say, I surrender, God. Take me into handcuffs and cuff me. Oh God, life is rough and life is tough, but I want you to cuff me, Jesus, and arrest me. Oh God, I'm willing to do whatever you want me to do. And when I was jobless, I'm talking in retrospect now, when I was going through it, I didn't know what was going on. But I was, now when I look back, I realize that I was jobless for Jesus. When I enrolled in Gordon Conwell to further my education, even in the doctorate program, I had no desire to be a counseling student. It was against my desire to leave a good paying job and do something that was outside of my sphere of control. But I could get no peace. Lord, I didn't want to do that, but I could get no peace because the Lord was pressuring upon my spirit to finish what he had started in me. And I was in tears when I told the headmaster of Union Academy, I got to leave this job and finish something. What the Lord well started. He said, Ron, you got everything in place. The infrastructure is built. Just be on call. You don't have to come in every day. Just be available. I told him, said, sir, with tears in my eyes, I said, I can't do it. I got to go finish something. Enroll back in Gordon Conwell into the doctorate program. Had to make my master's of theology in counseling. Looked like a master of divinity. So on top of all of my doctoral work, I had to take 11 to 12 more credits. Oh God, to make the adjustment, to make my master's of theology in Christian counseling look like a master's of divinity in theology. And I said, I can't do this. Church King said, you can do it, Ron. How many know that somebody is watching your life and they will encourage you when you needed it most? But by the grace of God, oh God, I took online courses and did the 12 credits and did all my doctoral work and finished and defended my thesis in 3 years. And doctor said, Parson did it in record time. I didn't know it, but listen to me, saints. When Jesus get behind you, or you'll be like Elijah. You can outrun a chariot. When Jesus is chasing you to do his will, you can run through troops and leap over walls. When you are the lost prisoner, you will get in a hurry and do what God called you to do. Lord have mercy. But God took me in a place where I had no history, had no background, had no knowledge of being a counselor, had no courses in counseling. I felt so out of place and ignorant. I knew very few of the terms. Oh God, I loved systematic theology because I could argue and debate. I loved apologetics. Get me in the Bible, and I'm like a kid in the candy store. And I sit in class with students who had undergrad studies in all the subjects that I had to try to figure out. I remember taking the DSM-4 or the statistical manual of the psychologist. I took that writing and I wrote a computer program that enabled me to look up terms quickly and have answers. I desired to hear the Lord say, I didn't tell you to do that. You made a mistake when you bumped your head in that accident. You thought you heard me. I wanted the Lord to let me out on parole. I promise I'll be good. I won't get into no more trouble. I'll do what I'm supposed to do. Let me out on parole, Jesus. But he said, no, you're going to serve your time. And thank God I finished the counseling with honors. Oh God, but somebody asked the advisor, how do you choose people to be in this program? He said, well, if we took the results of the psychological tests, wouldn't none of you be in this program? All of you got problems. He said, but take Parson as an example. He came in here not knowing anything, but he finished well. Oh yeah, Lord have mercy. In retrospect, I realized that what was driving me was I was in prison to what the Lord spoke to me and said, finish what you started. And since I finished what I started, look at what's going on now. Our counselors are busy helping folk navigate through this situation, the loss and the grief, the emotional changes and challenges. God aligned us with our assignment. So when trouble arises, we'll already be there waiting to do his will. I wish somebody would just throw up their hands and say, I give up. Arrest me, Jesus. I want to do what you call me to do. I want to see people as you see see them, oh God, as patients who need a physician. Lord, have mercy. I'm in prison so that people can be set free by Jesus. Somebody like me, you are jobless for Jesus. You are student for Christ. You are out of your league for the Lord. Somebody is going to look at you and be encouraged by your life, crucified for Christ. And now when I look back at all he brought me through, had it not been for the Lord who was on my side, oh God, I'll still be a fugitive of God's law. But thanks be to God who giveth us the victory. As I look back, that I was a student for Jesus, the one who apprehended me so that he could expand me to be more than I was before. I'm not over the counseling that brought me in, because I just wanted something to do. But